It is possible. It's very rare, but it's possible. Most people who have neuroendocrine tumors in the liver have metastases from either the gastrointestinal tract somewhere or the pancreas, most of them. But every once in a while, somebody will have one that arises primarily in the liver, presumably starting in a bile duct. The bile ducts have some neuroendocrine cells. The rest of the liver does not. And they can't start in the bile duct system, sometimes inside the liver, sometimes next to the liver in the bile ducts, or even in the gallbladder. But these are very rare, but they certainly can happen. And especially if there's one giant mass in the liver, no tumors anywhere else, that it makes the likelihood quite high that it actually is a primary tumor in the liver. And that's actually very good news, because if you do a big resection, you can essentially get out all the detectable cancer in the body. And in some of those people, they can remain in remission for a long, long time. Sometimes it never comes back. So that's actually a very favorable situation when it exists. But again, it's very rare. Okay. The answer is yes. People are certainly working on that. Now, intestinal carcinoids, neuroendocrine tumors that start in the small intestine, which is the single most common place for neuroendocrine tumors, are also very uncommonly something that runs in families. There are a few family kindreds in the United States where it does run in families. And for those people, they know it because a lot of relatives have carcinoid tumor. So if you have any, what we call first degree relative, a sibling, a parent, or a child with a neuroendocrine tumor, and you have a neuroendocrine tumor, that's called familial carcinoid tumor. And if you have such a thing, there's actually a doctor at the NIH, Dr. Stephen Wank, who studies these things specifically, and he's identifying genes that can be mutated that can cause this. But this is extraordinarily rare, and almost everybody who has a neuroendocrine tumor does not have the familial kind, and you don't have to worry about your children and other relatives popping up with a carcinoid tumor. Now, with pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, there are multiple family, familial inherited diseases that can give rise to pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, despite the fact that most people with pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors don't have these things. There's one called multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, MEN1. People get tumors in their parathyroid glands and pituitary, and they also get what we call foregut carcinoids, which mean foregut neuroendocrine tumors, which are the kind that start, for example, in the thymus gland, in the pancreas, in the lung. This can happen in MEN1. And that's a disease that does run in families. And almost everybody who has it has elevated calcium levels from the parathyroid tumors. And they know that they have relatives who have it. And then there are other familial syndromes as well. Again, rare. But people who have these tend to know and tend to get tested by genetic counselors. So this is another very rare and specialized condition. It's the goblet cell carcinoid. So a goblet cell carcinoid is a very unusual tumor that usually starts in the appendix. And it's not one of these benign, I shouldn't use the word benign, it's not one of these slow-growing appendix carcinoid tumors. It's a very aggressive type of appendix carcinoid, and has the capability of spreading more easily than the average appendix carcinoid. Goblet cell carcinoids have elements within the tumor that look like normal neuroendocrine tumor, and they have other elements in them that look like they are adenocarcinoma, which is cancer, normal cancer, not a carcinoid. So it's a combination of a carcinoid and a carcinoma, two kinds, carcinoid and carcinoma. Now, people have made classification systems for these that are a little complex, but basically some people with goblet cell carcinoids have something that starts out as a goblet cell carcinoid, but because the adenocarcinoma is so much more aggressive, it starts growing faster and faster and overgrows the situation. It's called adenocarcinoma ex goblet cell carcinoid. And if you have such a disease, it needs to be treated just like a colon carcinoma. So that can be what you're thinking about there. There are other people who have a adenocarcinoid, a goblet cell carcinoid that has adenocarcinoma elements that behave in a way that makes lots and lots of mucin, like a mucus thick gunk, and can start filling up the abdominal cavity with this and cause a disease that we call pseudomyxoma peritonei, and it needs to be surgically removed and sometimes treated with chemotherapy inside the abdominal cavity, and it has very specialized treatment. So even though goblet carcinoids are rare, within the group of goblet cell carcinoids, there are all different subgroups, and each of those needs very different treatment. Okay, an atypical carcinoid tumor of the lung is a neuroendocrine tumor, which is generally quite slow in its growth, and it's a little bit like a so-called typical carcinoid of the lung. Lung tumor carcinoids are classified differently than intestinal ones. We don't use the term typical and atypical for intestinal ones. We call them grade 1 or grade 2. But in lung, instead of calling them grade 1 and grade 2, they call them typical and atypical, which is the same basic concept, that the atypical ones grow a little bit faster and spread a little bit more. The biggest problem with atypical carcinoid treatment is that until very recently, when doctors went to the most commonly used guidelines for treatment, which is called NCCN, and they look up, what do you do for atypical carcinoid? So I haven't seen it in a long time, and I want to know what's going on. They have something, unfortunately, in those guidelines. It's been there until this year, saying, see small cell carcinoma of the lung. It doesn't say what to do. It just refers people to a page for small cell carcinoma of the lung. Unfortunately, if somebody sees small cell carcinoma of the lung, it says to use toxic chemotherapy with cisplatinum or carboplatin and etoposide as your primary treatment. Unfortunately, those drugs have lots and lots of side effects and don't usually work in atypical carcinoid. They work very well in high-grade, really high-grade lung neuroendocrine tumors like small cell carcinoma of the lung. But for atypical carcinoid, it's not usually very appropriate. So what happens is people get treated with really toxic things. They often don't have a good response. The doctors often don't know what to do. So the bottom line is that for atypical carcinoids, they should have a gallium 68 dotatate PET. If they have positive somatostatin receptors, they could potentially be treated like other carcinoid tumors with somatostatin analog-based therapy. They can respond to everolimus. That's a proven and approved a treatment for typical and atypical carcinoids, and they could potentially respond to things like PRRT if they have somatostatin receptors. They can respond to various types of chemotherapy, but it's important not to think of them in the same basket as small cell undifferentiated neuroendocrine carcinoma of the lung, which is a very, very aggressive kind of neuroendocrine lung cancer. No, it's related to a very specific situation with neuroendocrine neoplasia type 1, multiple endocrine neoplasia, MEN type 1. And that's specialized where people have hyperparathyroidism, parathyroid adenomas as part of the condition. But in general, you don't get high parathyroid activity from carcinoma.
Okay, thank you.
One more thing, sure. I should say, though, is elevated calcium. A lot of people associate that with hyperparathyroidism, with overactive parathyroid. One of the hormones that neuroendocrine cancers can make is called PTHRP. PTHRP means parathyroid hormone-related peptide. It's a medicine, it's a hormone that works like parathyroid hormone, but it's actually a different molecule. And that can be made by neuroendocrine cancers. It can make people have a high calcium. And that can get better when you treat the neuroendocrine cancer, either by removing it surgically or treating it with embolization or treating it with medications, and that can mimic hyperparathyroidism. So if somebody has high calcium and they have a carcinoid, they should not only check parathyroid hormone, which goes by the nickname of PTH, but they should also check this other hormone called PTHRP. that's becoming a more and more common issue. Mm. And in your particular case, if you could still have it or not, I can't tell you right now because it depends on what other laboratory tests are elevated, how high the 5-HIAA is, whether if it's a urine 5-HIAA, whether an appropriate low serotonin diet's been followed, whether it's a plasma 5-HIAA, and if that's been appropriately done, if that's what it is. So there are many, many, many factors that need to be discussed. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have a metastatic cancer all over your body if you have an elevated 5-HIAA, if it's just a little bit elevated. If it's super high, it certainly raises the possibility, and cancer needs to be looked for just to be sure that you don't have such a thing. I think exercise is wonderful. There's many, many, many studies showing that people who exercise do better with cancer treatment, have higher quality life. So many things about it are better, so that people should stay as active as they can. What is detrimental? Conceivably, if you're doing a lot of exercise, you're burning up more calories. So you have to be sure that you're eating enough and don't accelerate weight loss. If you're already on a downward spiral, you want to be sure that you reverse that by maintaining good nutrition. The other thing is that if people have carcinoid syndrome, which we didn't have too much time to talk about yet today, but carcinoid syndrome is a diarrhea and flushing and can lead to heart disease and other issues associated with having too much serotonin. If you have a situation like that, often exercise is a trigger that makes carcinoid syndrome worse, and you can get intense flushing or have to run to the toilet, diarrhea just from exercising. And in those situations, people can give an extra dose of subcutaneous octreotide before exercising, and then you can go run your marathon, or we have a medicine, telotrastat, that helps with diarrhea from carcinoid syndrome. You really need to work that with your doctor, how to treat these symptoms enough in advance that when you exercise, it doesn't cause extra trouble for you. It's a molecular test for trying to detect carcinoid tumors, neuroendocrine tumors, by looking at the blood with an analysis that can test the genes in the DNA, RNA, that are in the blood that can be tracers of cancer. The concept is very exciting, and it's being developed right now. Exactly how to use it in the general scheme of things is still being optimized. It looks like it might have a role in determining response to PRRT, and there are certain other situations where it may be good. So I think that's about all I can say for right now.